So who were the gods you, you know, what was that legacy when you joined a cricket team? You suddenly, the guys you were taking autographs from are the people who are your teammates and people asking you for autographs. So how does one become a god? I mean, what's that moment?
For me?
You're the only god.
Firstly, this word surprises me actually, because then I would have rather read 11 successful cricketers. That's very, very important, and that's what you play the sport. You know, during my playing days, I've watched so many champions. You know, we talk about names. You know, Virat Kohli is someone who I'm very passionate about. But my cricket, I grew up watching Sunil Gavaskar. He's just out? Okay.
Well, he's just got out.
Okay, he's just got out. So Sunil Gavaskar was someone who I grew up, and I'm sure Vinod during his days, being such a keen cricket follower, like all of us were, must have been influenced by the way he played fast bowling. Kapil Dev, with the effect he had on all of us. You know, the 1983 World Cup actually took us to this sport when I was a young boy, just 10 years of age. And I remember vividly that night in Kolkata. And I'm sure, Mala, you'll also remember, because you're an avid, vivid supporter, cricket supporter. Because, you know, Mala does this things on cricket because she's actually passionate about the game, and whatever I may tease her and say she was a McGrath supporter more than an Indian one, or a Steve Waugh supporter more than an Indian one. Not that he's named his son Taga after Steve Waugh, in spite of us beating Steve Waugh so many times during that period, but she is an avid cricket lover. So from that point of view, I think these were the names. Being a left-hander, I enjoyed David Gawar. I used to hear many a times that, you know, he's a laid-back person, he's a lazy person. And I used to tell my friends that laid back, lazy, 100 test matches, 8,500 runs, it doesn't come being laid back and lazy. So these are the players I've grown up watching. But for me, Sunil Gavaskar and Kapil Dev were two revolutionaries actually, who actually brought young boys back to the cricket field and played with Sachin, who I thought was a genius. And then now this young fellow, Virat Kohli, you know, everybody asks me, why do you support him so much? I said, I can't do anything but support him, because every time I see him play, you know, I just get a feeling that he's just going to take this country forward.
So these are the stories of one god about the other gods. So Mr. Rai, you came into cricket at a time which was very difficult. So I'll ask you two questions, one after another. One is, he mentioned you were a cricket enthusiast. Now that term is also fraught with danger in this country, but he was a cricket fan. So what were your memories of cricket? Did you play at some level?
Oh well, I'm actually the fly in the ointment, because there's the god, there's the billions. Now I'm the kebab mein haddi who's become the auditor, come civil servant, come cricket administrator today, making a mess of everything. But my memories, as my white hair will indicate, are of Polly Umrigar, Vijay Manjrekar, Ramakant Desai, Chandrasekhar, etc. I still have a notebook in which newspaper cuttings, photographs of those cricketers I used to stick and keep. And that was, I think, 1962 West Indian series or something they played in Delhi. I mean, that's my earliest memories of cricket.
I did that as well, actually, when I was young. I used to cut pictures and make a book and of the great players during my era, during my growing up. Because I grew up in a cricket family. You know, my father was involved so hugely with the game. My brother played the game. And, you know, in Calcutta, you cannot stay without cricket, because everybody is obsessed with cricket. You know, when you were growing up, you watched people playing on the streets. Today, I was driving in the morning past the governor house, and I saw one street closed and young boys playing cricket with the tennis ball. So it's a city where cricket gets to you. I still remember going to Eden Gardens when I was 8 or 9 years of age, and I used to sit on that Sunday or rather the winter test matches, and it was a fascinating atmosphere, just like it is today. You know, I entered this Victoria Memorial today, and I thought, this is the best place in the country. I don't get into this place much often, but when you look around, it's just so beautiful on a winter afternoon. And when you watch test matches at Eden Gardens those days, test cricket, in a white shirt, red ball, Kapil Dev swinging the ball away from the right hander, it was an unbelievable experience. Also an opportunity to get away from home, because my mother would make me do mathematics when India is playing at Eden Gardens. So that's an opportunity to get away from home as well.
So this particular spell of questioning was the Luzoners. So now we go into the slightly darker phase of what brought Mr. Rai into the cricket firmament as an, you know, as somebody to clean the stadium, the stables and the stadia actually. So is it reasonable for us as a country which is grappling with corruption? We just had a session with Mr. Ram which says scams are here to stay. So with such an honesty deficit, is it reasonable to have expected that cricket will be this squeaky clean, you know, part of our national lives when it is so high profile, when politicians get into it? It is the one, cricket is the one thing in which people don't have to hire others to burn effigies. People do it for free. So in such high passion and, you know, is it at all reasonable? Or why were we surprised when the first match fixing broke, which happened in 2000, and then the recent controversies again surfaced?
Well, I won't say that it's unfair of us to believe that would happen. I would only believe that when we heard about it first time, I think it just broke a billion hearts. That's about
all. That's in 2000, Hansi Cronje.
Exactly. It just broke about a billion hearts because you are so passionate about the game and you look up to the gods and you think that the gods can...
Sir, can you call me Saurav? It will be easier for me to get through this evening.
No, but this evening is dedicated to the gods. So anyway, so the point is you revere the cricketers so much in this country that you don't ever would like to believe that they could do a wrong. And when something like that happens, it just breaks your heart. That's about all. It's a trust which breaks.
But Hansi Cronje did it, not our boys.
So the fact that it can happen in cricket, is a thing.
Yeah, a cricket captain who was considered one of the most iconic ones, who led his team after, you know, the isolation, to see him just crumble in front of, you know, national eyes. So Borea, does your book speak about, I mean, it's like Dream Team 1, Dream Team 2 in NBA, so you have, you know, first round of match fixing, second round of match fixing. So do you go back in time to address that, or has so much happened recently that you didn't feel those incidents bear mentioning?
No, absolutely I do. I mean, in fact, I know that the first question that sports fans in this country would immediately, on picking up a book, ask is, has he written about match fixing? Yes, I have. It's the first chapter. And I say that in 2000, an opportunity was lost in trying to cleanse the game, which is why maybe 2013 happened. And I delve at length how the 2013 saga unfolded, how the Committee of Administrators, for example, came into existence as a result of the corruption, the Mudgal Committee, the Lodha Committee. In fact, I'll tell you another anecdote. One of the key members of the Lodha Committee is quoted at length in the book, tell me that the two teams who got suspended, the way the two teams represented themselves in front of the Lodha Committee said a lot. So I said, what? So I was told that Chennai Super Kings would always come with a team of lawyers and Rajasthan Royals would always put Rahul Dravid in front. And the person concerned, read the book in April, said, quote, he said, you know, the first day Rahul Dravid was brought to the meeting, the question I asked of myself was, how will the three judges react? Will Justice Lodha play fanboy? Will Justice Ravindran and Justice Bhan play fanboy and tell Rahul, okay, we'll take autographs? Or will they actually ask Rahul Dravid the questions? To his credit, Justice Lodha apparently, and I mentioned this, Justice Lodha told Rahul, you're a great icon of Indian cricket, but for this hearing or this meeting, we don't need you. So we will call you if need be. And I was told that's when he understood that this committee means business. So I actually go into as much detail, as much depth as possible.
Well, what were your thoughts when match fixing had broken at that point, when, you know, some of your own teammates were under scrutiny? How hard was it to lead that team with so much surround sound in cricket?
Actually, you know, when that was going on in India, I was away in Lancashire. It was year 2000 and I was playing county cricket. Me, Rahul and Anil were in different teams in county cricket, and media and news was not so fire-like in those days. You know, I'm not sure whether the computer in the sport had taken its such a big stride. So half the information I wouldn't even get. There was no cable television, and now you go to England and you go to America, you see the Star News, the NDTVs, and the India Todays. The news going live to that part of the world. When I was there that time in 2000, nothing of that sort was there, and half the information I did not get. And I was fortunate that I was away. I was away playing county cricket, so I believe some of them got pulled up by the investigation agencies to come and find out. Luckily, I was away and I couldn't come back. They'd asked me to come, but I said I'm playing and I won't be able to get back. And then when I came back 6 months later, I just got a new team to play. I was just told that this and this is what it is. You just got to play with this new team, and then I played with this new team, and we just kept going forward. So I really wouldn't pinpoint on names, because actually, honestly, I wasn't aware of the situation. Even what Boreya says about Rahul, I just heard it for the first time from Boreya, so I'm not exactly aware. And this is such a sensitive issue, such a sensitive topic. You should be completely sure of what is happening before you actually make a statement. But then, as I said, came in with a clean slate. I was fortunate enough to have some fantastic cricketers. The biggest advantage of Indian cricket is, with every generation you get champions. In the past, the systems never produced it, but in the current scenario, systems produce it. And you look at the stadiums all around the country, look at the money which has come into the game. But when we were growing up, there was no money. There was no money in the sport. I remember going in 1992 to Australia. I was there for about 4 months, and the total money we got was 30,000 rupees. And I believe 30,000 rupees you get per second probably in this time in modern day cricket. So you had to deal with it. So when I came in, I had players like Tendulkar, Dravid, myself, VVS, Anil Kumble. They were just outstanding cricketers. And we couldn't miss the players who went away. And Anil and Rahul and Sachin. And we just kept going forward as a team. So probably God was kind enough that I was fortunate enough to lead such a wonderful brand of cricketers who's actually changed the face of Indian cricket. MS Dhoni, who came afterwards. The best thing, or rather the most fortunate thing which I experienced during the players, during that period, was how players wanted Indian cricket to be at its best. They had the talent, but they had the mindset also. It's not just about talent which takes you forward, but it's the mindset which actually makes the difference. And all these boys were there to make a difference to Indian sport. And we saw that over a period of 5 years. We started going away and winning. We were always a very good team in India. In India, you never needed a captain. And at times, during the period when I was captain for 6 years, I would just actually stand at point and throw the ball to Anil and Harbhajan. They would put the fielders and win you test matches. But when you went away, it got a bit more difficult because the game completely changed.
We are aware of that even now.
Yeah, so change. So from that point of view, it really helped. And sometimes, I've always believed in life that sometimes good things happen in an accident. When you go through a bad time, when you go through a crisis, you invariably actually see the best out of you. It happened to me also. When I got dropped in 2006 for whatever reasons, I came back and played those 3 years and probably batted my best. The day I finished and I decided to quit, Sachin came and told me that, why are you finishing? I said, I just want to finish. He said, this is the best I've seen you play in the last 3 or 4 years. So sometimes crisis, adversities actually get the best out of you. And I thought I was fortunate enough to lead a marvelous team.
Day before yesterday, Mr. Rai, I was interviewing Saurav. He and I, we work for the same television station, India Today, and we were doing a show, sort of just back from New Zealand. So I was feeding him balls outside the off stump, and he was hitting them for boundaries. Great Indian under 19 team, fast bowlers, batsman. And I had to ask him the question. I know he would smile. I said, I don't know how many years later, in one cricket ground, there were four characters: Saurav Ganguly, Rahul Dravid, Steve Waugh, and a certain Greg Chappell. Did you talk? And Saurav looks at me and he says, you had to ask that. I said, I had to ask that. And he says, I took Rahul out for dinner. We had a great dinner. He said, XXX. Steve, he was nervous about his son. And then Saurav goes on to talk about Steve and how nervous he was. And it goes on. The answer goes on. And I'm waiting. Will Saurav tell me about Chappell? And he stops. And I said, Saurav and Greg, and he says, quote, he's here, I'm not putting words into his mouth. He said, with Greg, the only thing you should do is stay away. That's how you are safe. It's on YouTube if you want to hear those words.
I think you were at a toss with him at one of the IPL games as well.
Well, I was not there to take people out for dinner. I was out there to work, to commentate. And I met Rahul because, you know, I am the chairman of the technical committee who actually decides how Indian plays, where India goes, how the under-19 boys are playing. So I met him right up and said, I haven't met you for long because you've been traveling. How are the boys doing? So he said, the boys are fantastic. And that's what I was there for. Today they beat Bangladesh in the quarterfinals and they move into the under-19 semifinals with Pakistan. So that was my job and I did exactly that. You know, that's what journalists do to you on your left and on your right. That they'll always ask you the wrong questions and then they'll put it on YouTube. Well, that's the saddest part of
it.
Live streaming. It's not even a time.
No, I didn't say with Greg, the only thing you do is stay away and be safe. I didn't say that. I didn't say in the chat, ask Saurabh. I mean, Mala can ask Saurabh. When he went and scored the 51 in Johannesburg, which to me and to many of you, if you've watched that, I'm sure Mr. Vinod Rai will agree, one of the best innings from an Indian on foreign soil. When he came back to the dressing room and I asked him for the book, what did Greg tell you? That's my job to ask. And he said, quote, if I remember from memory, it's in the book, he said, all he said was, I don't know what happened was good or bad, but welcome. Am I right?
I don't remember. Please read the book.
Okay, now moving to Mr. Rai. We are now moving to the time when you came in as, you know, to take over and try to set the house in order. So, are you happy with the progress? What are the challenges? What exactly makes this so hard? You know, there are various things which we know obviously need to be done, but it is taking time. So, how patient a man are you?
See, patience is not a problem. One is retired, unemployed, has nothing better to do. So he's got lots of time and hence lots of patience, lots of perseverance one will go through with it. But now that the issue has been engaged through the courts in India take time. So one will have to persevere. But look, this is not a problem of immediate occurrence. We've had these problems which are glitches in the administration of the BCCI or any other sports body in the country. I don't know, I think none of you three were born, 1967, West Indies playing in Eden Gardens, there were those riots. And the riots, a commissioner of inquiry was set up. And the commissioner of inquiry gave his report and said it was all bad management by the BCCI, which means the crowd, the spectators had not been given adequate facilities, minimum requirements such as toilets and things were not there. So it's an issue which has built up over time. It's an issue which unfortunately because of vested interests had to go to court. It's an issue in which people have developed roots and hence it's going to take a while before those roots can be disengaged from the interest into which they are. But we are hoping, and we are hoping only because of the fact that there is this trust of 1 billion people in this country who really look up to cricket for entertainment and good entertainment. And the fact that we are just about the best team in the world today, that we will be able to, in large number of ways, cleanse the system and ensure that cricket administration, which I think is an honest broker between the cricketers on one side, I won't say gods, Saurabh, the cricketers on one side, and the billions on the other side, the facilitator is the BCCI, will be a good and a well-governed system.
Can you talk us through what you know about the Kohli Kumble situation? Is it mentioned in your book?
Yeah, there is. I don't want to talk about it because it's for you to read in April. I'll still give you a glimpse. Yes, it's mentioned at length. There is a full chapter dedicated to it. In fact, the coach-captain thing where I come from cricket and football as to why it happened the way it happened. Saurabh, Greg, it doesn't end with Saurabh, Greg, there's Saurabh Buchanan as well. And another Australian.
There is no Saurabh Buchanan as well.
Every time,
every time the beneficiary was Saurabh Ganguly.
No, I'm not. In my book, Saurav is actually a god. I mean, the way I celebrate the way Indian cricket went forward, and there are a lot of funny stories. You know, today Mr. Rai was telling me over lunch that Saurav opening his shirt at Lord's was a definitive moment for him. No, I'm not saying. Mr. Rai said this over lunch, and it's a fact. I analyze that. Lord's traditionalism, conservatism, a Bengali middle class, not upper middle class, not with Salman Khan six-pack abs, opening his shirt at the Lord's balcony.
Well, Boria in 2002, I was not far away either.
No, he was quite
fit. I was fit, young, and
fabulous.
May not be six, but
three for sure.
Which of you thought he was fit then? Please raise your hands.
Okay.
Yes.
So, see, for me, the moment was, I mean, I keep saying, I'll say two stories, okay, in 1.5 minutes and give it to you. For me, every time if any of you go to Lord's and go to the Lord's Museum, you will see 55% visitors are from India. 55 to 60%. Entire number of people who visit the Lord's Museum every year. And you should go and check the register and ask the person there, and what do they want? And immediately you will see a smile, and the first statement is, they ask, where did Saurav Ganguly open his shirt? I'm not making up. That's a fact. Now for me, why is Saurav so important? Forget Saurav as a friend or whatever. This is a favorite story of mine. I keep saying this, and this is not from me. Michael Clark is quoted in the book as saying this story. Mala knows the story. I'll say it for you. In an Australian dressing room, Michael tells me, and I took Michael to Saurav's house over lunch, and the story got corroborated. Michael says Ricky Ponting was sitting like this, and the whole Australian dressing room was, what's happened? And he says, you know what? At the toss with Saurav Ganguly, Saurav said head tail. And he picked up the coin, he said head tail. And I said, Michael, come on, this is not happening. He said, okay. Ricky said, Saurav picked up the coin, gave it to me and said, we are batting, and walked off. Now, true or not, True or not, I don't care. The fact is, an Australian cricket captain is quoted in the book, is willing to be quoted in the book. Now, what does this tell you about a change in Indian mindset under this man? That, for me, is the definitive thing. Forget the story. By the way, tailpiece, the story is true.
You said 18.
You know what happened a year later in a test match? Ricky Ponting took a 1 pound catch and said I was out. So whichever way you look at it. Whichever way you look at it. So, and secondly, that t-shirt opening incident, you know, before I went, I had this huge problem or advantage or disadvantage that my mother, every time I used to go on a big trip, big tour, would snatch my chain 2 days before I left for the series. So you know, when your mom asks you to do certain things, you do it, because at the end of the day, she's your mother. So I used to every time give it back to her, and then she would just put me on the morning before I leave. I said, why do you take it every time? She said, no, you don't worry about it, you just put it and go. So every time she would do it, and I would change my shirt and see another stone added to my chain. So I asked her one day, ki ma, is all my stars bad? She said, why do you ask that? I said, every time I go on a tour, I see a blue or a red or a green or some new stone on my chain. So I presume that all my stars are bad and you're fixing things up. So the reason I took that shirt off was because we won the NatWest trophy, and my mother said, when you win it, you must show all what you have. So that's exactly what I did for you.
See, you didn't tell me this one. This is for the second edition, Simon.
I showed all what I have.
Fiction.
And I showed, and I told the world, hey, listen, the reason India got 325 that evening, that fantastic Saturday afternoon at Lord's, which was chock-a-block, because playing India at Lord's or England at Lord's is like a home game. There are more Indians than Englishmen. And Englishmen are absolute passive watchers of a cricket match with the Indian flags and the Indian music and the noise. So you can imagine, you know, I went to New Zealand this time and I asked, what's the population? They said it's actually half of New Delhi. So from that point of view, you know, it was a great afternoon. My uncle, who lives in England, he comes to watch cricket matches, and he's so nervous about me playing, and that every time I walk into bat, he puts his head down on the shoes. And once the ball is over, he would look up at the television screen and watch the highlights. In a cricket ground, So there was a Britisher sitting next to him, and he said, "Mate, you must be very rich." So he asked him, "Why do you say that?" He said, "You've paid £100 for a ticket. You didn't know that I gave him the ticket and it was free." So he said, £100 for a ticket and you keep watching your shoes." So my uncle couldn't answer anything because he couldn't say it was Saurav Ganguly's uncle, and he just listened. And he's a very typical Bengali, very quiet. You know, moment they live in England, they become very conservative. And he left the ground. He left the ground after we were 147 for five, and he was on the motorway back home in Harrow. So as he went half down the motorway, and he was hearing the commentary and Yuvraj and Kaif for hitting boundaries. So halfway down the motorway, he turned back. India were 220 for five, and he turned back and came back to Lords, and took his ticket and went and saw India win. So I had to take my T-shirt off to say to my mother that, listen, these things are working.
So Bora, you've studied about cricket history, you've worked with generations, the last three generations of the game in India and overseas. So what are your thoughts? Why did you write this book? Is it a labor of love, or does it have angry parts?
No, I started saying this, and I will finish off saying it, that someone who's observed the game for 25, 30 years now, someone who studied it for a PhD and makes a living out of it, I thought I owe it to myself, to everyone who reads, listens, loves this game, to have a document that they can call objective, that they can call, this is the authentic document on India's cricket history. Because whatever I've read, and I can claim I've read practically everything that there's out there on India cricket, I've sort of said, he was fortunate. I am fortunate because I forever wanted to document this game and talk about the 11 gods and a billion Indians. And when I sit out there, I mean, I have the best view as a journalist. I have the best view as an academic to be objective and analyze what goes on. And as I said, I'm also privy to anecdotes. And just one more to close off. This friend of mine, Rajneesh, who's here today, a lawyer who's now in this business of sport, he was telling me, and I shared with Saurav on the way, he said, you know, Rahul Dravid's wife and Virendra Sehwag's wife were watching a match at the Garware. Saurav said, mentioned the Garware. And Virendra Sehwag got out after 2.5 hours scoring 100. So Rahul's wife tells Sehwag's wife, Aarti, that you are so fortunate, you can now go. And I will have to sit here for the next 2 days and I still don't know whether I will see 100. Now my thing is, I'm privy to this. I'm privy to what goes on out there. I'm privy to speaking to Mr. Rai and getting to know the real stories. And then if I do not put it out for my audience, be it on TV, be it on radio, be it in print, then I think I'm doing a disservice to myself and the profession.
Which means I better be careful.
With Borea, you have to always be careful.
You know, that's why the best thing I did when I got married, I said, Donna, you must pursue your dance career. So you will be on the stage more than on the cricket field.
Okay, now we throw it open and we'll start with Mr. Ram. We'll come to you. You've got 3-4 questions. We'll go girl, boy, girl. First, Mr. Ram, do you have any idea what the score is?
6 wickets down, lead of about 150. He's batting well and scoring quickly. Mr. Vinod Rai. Mr. Rai, the several matters are pending before the Supreme Court, which doesn't seem to be making haste in determining it. For example, your committee has only 2, whereas you need more. Several other matters relating to the future of the BCCI and state associations are up there. Are you getting frustrated or are you hopeful that this help, the directions you seek and so on, will come soon?
I'm exceedingly hopeful that we will get there. How much of time we'll take in getting there, of course, I cannot say just now, but I'm very hopeful that we will be able to achieve the objectives that the Supreme Court wanted us to achieve and that all the cricket-loving population of this country wants to see.
The lady in the second.
My question is to Mr. Saurav Ganguly. I know you're a cricket icon, but I also know in school you were very fond of playing football. Do you still follow football?
I do.
And if yes, which is your club and who is your favourite footballer?
Well, my club is Atletico. ATK, Atletico de Kolkata. I follow Manchester United very closely.
And your favourite footballer?
Diego Maradona. Yay!
I meant current
football. Who do you want to hear, Ronaldo or Messi?
No, Neymar.
No, I think Messi is by far the best.
The boy there, the con.
I'm extremely honored to be able to direct this question to all you. Thank you for this wonderful session. This is a question that has been haunting me since I was in class 8, I would remember. The 2003 World Cup final for me, it was... the god was that bit far away from holding that crown. I would remember that for me, Sourav Ganguly was most valiant when he was playing on the front foot, or even more when he was stepping out. So, what happened at the toss? It was for everybody, for me even. I used to watch cricket very closely. Even for me, I was hoping that, since I used to watch Sachin Tendulkar even closely, that he used to score more runs when he was playing in the first innings. What happened at the toss? Were you playing on the back foot? Were the demons of that 125 all out playing in your mind at the final?
No, it was, if you remember, it rained overnight and the game started late. And if you remember, on the morning of the final, there were actually dryers on the pitch. It's the same Wanderers where a test match is going on now. There were dryers on the pitch to dry the ground, dry the surface. So which means there was a lot of moisture underneath. So that's the reason I put them in, saying that if I can get them out for 220, 230, we'll win this game. Because batting second at the Wanderers was a fantastic batting surface. But then Ricky Ponting played superbly that afternoon. And I think we were up against a fantastic cricket team, the best cricket team I've seen in the last 30, 40 years, the Australia team of that era.
One I'm supposed to like.
Yes.
One must always love excellence, the bespectacled gentleman.
My question is, having so prolifically played fast bowling while your career, so you have faced Aaron Donald at his prime in 1997 tour, and also McGrath in the 1999 tour. So who would you rate as a better fast bowler and why, between Donald and McGrath?
I think they're both outstanding, but McGrath will be ahead. You know, McGrath was a fantastic bowler. You know, length and line and discipline. He would hardly give you anything to hit. A fantastic bowler, Glenn McGrath.
Okay, there's a gentleman there.
Can I ask the question in Bengali?
Yes. Certainly.
My question to Dada. Je Bharatiya cricket emoni ekta janopriyotar minar je shekhane jarai khelen taderkei ottonto janopriyotar shonge amra ishwar hisebe mene ni. তো আপনার কি মনে হয় যে আগামী দিনে যারা ভারতীয় ক্রিকেটে আসতে চলেছেন তাদের মাঠ এবং মাঠের বাইরে আরো বেশি ভাবে সচেতন জীবন যাপন করা উচিত ঈশ্বর হিসেবে পরিগণিত হওয়ার জন্য আরেকটা কোশ্চেন বলি আপনার কাছে যে আপনার কাছে কতটা কঠিন ছিল ঠিক 11 জনকে বেছে নেওয়া ঈশ্বর হিসেবে
বাছিনি এনিওয়ান আপনি যে প্রশ্নটা দিয়ে শুরু করলেন ওয়ান সেন্টেন্স আনসার এনিওয়ান হু ডনস এন ইন্ডিয়ান জার্সি বিকামস ওভারনাইট এসকালেটেড টু বিইং রিভিয়ার্ড সো আমার It's not a book about 11 players. It's a history of Indian cricket.
তোমার প্রশ্নের উত্তর হচ্ছে নিশ্চয়ই আমি 100 বার মনে করি যখন when you're a public person, a role model, তোমাকে মাঠের বাইরে ব্যবহার ঠিক রাখতেই হবে আর রাখিও অনেক সময় কি হয় একটা নরমাল মানুষ যেটা করে সেটা ওভারলুক হয়ে যায় আর একটা স্পোর্টসম্যান যেটা করে সেটা অনেক বড় করে দেখানো হয় কারণ at the end of the day they sell. So সেই জিনিসটাকে ওদের একটু হ্যান্ডিক্যাপ বলে আমি মনে করি
I'm taking the final question from a lady because we have to keep the gender balance in order. Yes.
Thank you for a wonderful discussion and honest answers. We appreciate that.
Thank you, ma'am.
Now my question is to Sourav, sir. Throughout the evening you have denied, please don't call me a god, call me Sourav. The display of humility, really. But the question is about that word, God.
I actually don't think it should be used for cricketers.
I understand. But for the public and for billion hearts, the respect is probably for the jersey.
So what's your question, man?
What does this respect, this awe towards the jersey and of the billion hearts mean to you personally? How do you balance
Okay, we got
it. You said you just turn around anywhere and you know.
Yes, we got it.
What does this mean to you personally?
Yes, I'll also add an addendum. Also, sometimes you're treated as the word that turns, when you turn God the other way, when you lose. So how do you also deal with these extremes? Because sometimes that happens and it is quite regrettable.
Yeah, it's very true what Mala said and you just have to deal with it. That's why it's important to just pursue the journey. Of a cricketer. Just play the sport in the right manner, try and perform. I am a firm believer in life that you cannot control things which are beyond your control. and the job of a cricketer is to just play properly, and that's what we did. We had to play properly, otherwise he would not be in the team. And as I said during this conversation, that this was very close to our hearts. This is something which we wanted to do, we love to do. And to continue doing that, you had to play properly and get runs and win matches, because competition was so much. There's so many good cricketers in this country, and that's been happening for the last 35-40 years. You know, you lose your place, you find it so hard to get it back. So from that point of view, I never thought about that. All what I was taught when I was through my international career was it's that red ball and your cricket bat. You either perform or somebody else will.
Can I make one
announcement? Yes.
You know, anyone who wants a copy of one of the chapters which we are releasing as a sample, it's available at Story to pick up free of cost. So just do that on your way out. The bookstore that is outside. So one of the chapters which actually involves Saurav is available for all of you to pick up.
So thank you, Borya. Thank you for this wonderful session. Thank you, Mr. Rai. It's much nicer to be with Maharaja than A Raja. So, and thank you, Saurav, for you know, being here for the second time at the Literary Meet. You were with us in 2013. Please do look out for The 11 Gods and A Billion Indians by Borya Majumdar.